Good morning. Welcome to Chalice Unitarian Universalist Congregation. We are a community of diverse beliefs and experiences, nurturing the liberal religious spirit and united by our desire to grow in love and in service. Whoever you are, whomever you love, whatever your life's journey, you are welcome here. Whether you gather with us every Sunday, once or twice a year, or are with us this morning for the first time, we're glad you're here. I'm Reverend Sharon Wiley, Chalice's minister. Our worship musician this morning is Justin Gray. Welcome to this online worship service. Welcome to those of you watching live using Zoom on Sunday morning. And welcome to those of you who are watching the recording of this service later on Chalice's YouTube channel. For those of us using Zoom, please notice on your Zoom menu, you have a button that says CC Live Transcript. This is Zoom's closed captioning service. You can click on it to hide the subtitle or show the subtitle. You're in control of whether that is on or off on your screen. Also on your menu is the chat button. For those of you who like to use the chat box during the service, which you're welcome to do, please be sure that when you post that you use that little blue drop-down menu to select everyone. I think it says hosts and panelists when you first bring it up. If you only post to the host and panelists, that's just me. I may not see your message during the service and I may not realize that it only came to me. So let's all give ourselves a big hug of hello and welcome. I want to especially welcome those of you who are newcomers at Chalice this morning. Towards the end of the service, I will put a link in the chat box for adding your name to our email list. Our weekly email is the best way to get information about our groups and activities. We are still offering maybe most of our groups using Zoom, but we're beginning the transition to being able to do some things in person. So being able to keep in touch with what's happening at the congregation is especially important right now. Now, let's take a breath together.
Good morning. According to the Library of Congress, the first permanent Euro-American settlements began a pattern of displacement and land appropriation of indigenous people that continued until the 20th century. In this region that we consider home, the Kumeyaay first lived here for over 10,000 years and were the people who greeted the Spanish when they first sailed into the San Diego Harbor in 1542. With this awareness, we acknowledge that Chalice is located on the stolen, tribal, ancestral homeland of the Apai, which is part of the Kumeyaay Nation, and the Payamkwechim Nation. This acknowledgement reminds us that we live in a history-driven present and that we need to be intentional with this land and with the people indigenous to the land. Mary Lyons from the Leech Lake Band of Ojibwe states, "When we, the indigenous people, talk about land, land is part of who we are. It is a mixture of our blood, our past, our current, and our future. According to the research done with Reclaiming Native Truth, 40% of Americans do not believe that indigenous people still exist in the U.S. Chalice hopes that with our first step of land acknowledgement, we can move towards educating ourselves and others about indigenous communities and their rich and diverse culture and create a meaningful relationship with them as well."
Now we light our chalice, the symbol of our Unitarian Universalist faith. This solstice time, in honor of ancient traditions that celebrate this time of longest night, we observe that the flaming chalice holds the elements of the four directions: earth, air, fire, water. The lamp oil for earth, the air that feeds the flame, the fire we light, and the chalice itself, the cup, the symbol of water. We light our chalice and reflect on the light we need to guide us through hard times, the light of our shared faith, the light of loving community, the light of love, joy, and hope. May our chalice flame burn brightly, that its light may shine for everyone. Our call to worship. It is okay to be tired of change and fear. It is okay to be tired of everything different and everything bad and everything scary. Okay to feel weary of resiliency and wholeness and learning and growth, and okay to yearn simply for rest. It's okay to be grouchy and unsatisfied, and all the ordinary human ways of being that we are. Let this morning be a reminder that you are loved. Let our time together soothe what is restless in you. May you be comforted in knowing that whatever you are feeling today and other days, you are not alone. You are never alone. Let us worship together.
This morning marks the fourth Sunday in the season of Advent in the Christian tradition. Each week until Christmas, we have been lighting a new candle on the Advent wreath, symbols of hope, peace, joy, and love. As the season reaches its completion, we prepare for new life to dawn, our hearts soften, and our arms open to embrace its brightness. This morning, we light the fourth candle. We light this candle as a reminder that there is no greater power in the world than love. Through this community, we can become a blessing to one another. Our love is magnified and lives are changed. We can hardly wait any longer for the wonder of love to be revealed. May we risk enough to become vulnerable and welcome holy tenderness.
Our Advent hymn this year is from our gray hymnal number 226, People Look East. Please join in singing. Thank you. Our Sunday worship is the shared spiritual practice of our community, and we tend to the congregation during this time by sharing and honoring our joys and sorrows. If you'd like to share a joy or sorrow with the congregation this morning, now is the time for sharing in the chat box. These won't be spoken out loud. They don't become part of the recording. If you'd like to send me a confidential note about your joy or sorrow, or to make a prayer request, please email me. I'll put my email address in the chat box.
Thank you. solstices are a planet's longest and shortest days of the year. The longest day often marks the beginning of summer and is called the summer solstice. The shortest day often marks the beginning of winter and is thus called the winter solstice. The Northern Hemisphere's summer solstice happens in June. When the North Pole is tilted most directly toward the sun. This tilt means the summer solstice has the most hours of sunlight and is the brightest day of the year. The Northern Hemisphere's winter solstice happens in December, when the North Pole is tilted furthest away from the sun. Because of this, the winter solstice has the fewest hours of sunlight and is the darkest day of the year. In the southern hemisphere, where the seasons are flipped, the situation is reversed. Because the exact solstice dates may vary year to year on calendars, meteorologists do not use them to mark the seasons. That means the day of the winter solstice may not always correspond with the first day of winter. Both the summer and winter solstices, along with the autumnal and vernal equinoxes, help shepherd in the changing of the seasons.
The wheel of the year turns to winter. The pagan wheel of the year recognizes the cycle of the seasons. Spring is the time of birth, when young plants begin to grow. Summer, the time of ripening, of flourishing, of blossom. Autumn is the time of harvest and slowing down. And winter, for us in Southern California, the rainy season, we hope, is a time of rest, of dormancy, and of letting go. This cycle of birth, flourishing, slowing down, and dormancy repeats again and again in all measurements of time. We feel it throughout the day, from the freshness of morning, the peak hours of daytime that find us doing, the slowing down of evening, and the time of rest as we sleep at night. We feel it throughout our lives, from the energy of youth, the fullness of adulthood, the slowing down of aging, and the decline as we near the end of life. In pagan tradition, darkness isn't seen as scary or evil. For pagans, darkness is understood as part of the natural cycle. The moon is dark for 2 to 4 days of the month. We need the nighttime for rest and rejuvenation. Animals hibernate to conserve energy. To slow down and let go is perfectly natural.
The harvest is over. Settles in. The nights are getting longer, the chilly winter wind. And I whisper in the moonlight, when will sun return? And I whisper in the moonlight, when will sun return? The animals hibernate, snow may begin. The evergreens listen, nearing solstice again. And I whisper in the moonlight, when will sun return? And I whisper in the moonlight, when will sun return? I sit here and reflect on the year that has passed. My family and friendships. Whisper in the moonlight, when will sun return? presence and Zooming with friends. There's church and time to ponder. We look deep within. Then I whisper in the moonlight, when will peace return? Then I whisper in the moonlight, when will light return?
The Holly King and the Oak King, an ancient tale retold by J.C. Artemisia and illustrated by Sarah A. Chase. Long ago, there was a mountain so tall it scraped the sky, reaching the spirits of the sun, the moon, and the stars. The spirits admired this mountain and blessed its forest with an abundance of magic, allowing it to be both warm and cool, dark and light at once. One night, when the mountain lay in half-summer, half-winter slumber, a rumble climbed through the tall peaks, rattling trees, crumbling rocks, and shivering out into the universe. The echoes from this quake crashed into two nearby stars, knocking them loose from the sky. One of the fallen stars nestled into a patch of holly. The other tumbled onto oak tree roots. When the stars finally flickered out, the forest creatures bowed their heads. The weather reflected their sadness with soft rain and deep wind, lifting the crumbled stars, swirling and pulsing with the mountain's magic. Twin gods, the Holly and Oak Kings, were born from this stardust. Oak and holly settled into the forest, aligning with the shifts in mountain temperament and weather. Oak was playful and spirited, always adventuring with his chirpy robin friend. Oak's energy buzzed through the forest, lighting the sky, lifting the air, and waking the flowers on the eastern mountainside. Holly dwelled on the western slope with his team of 8 white stags. Holly was quieter and more reflective than his brother. He foraged and prepared, preferring stillness and darkness for reverent thought and dreaming. But for all his concentration, he was also strong and steadfast, always caring for the night creatures around him. Despite their differences, the brothers loved each other. They prayed daily at a stone table on the mountain's north side, frequently walking together afterward, but most often dueling. The kings lived to battle one another. One afternoon, while walking an eastern trail, the brothers admired colorful gardens blooming in the sunshine. Fiery tiger lilies stretched on strong stalks, but beneath the peppered orange petals, soft white buds shied away. "Moonflowers," said Holly, "look how they hide. The sunlight on this mountainside is too bright. They will not survive." Holly raised his vine-wrapped walking staff toward the sky and magically pulled the leafy forest canopy closed like a curtain. As darkness covered the forest path, the moonflowers yawned open their delicate petals. The Holly King smiled at the sleepy flowers, but his brother wasn't so happy. "Brother," the Oak King bellowed, "the moonflowers are not hiding. They are protected. With time, the tiger lilies will grow larger to cast greater shade, but they cannot thrive in shadows." Oak raised his twisted honey gold staff and reopened the forest canopy. Holly aimed his staff once more, but before he could cast his power at the treetops, Oak swung his staff to meet Holly's. Crack! Oak thrusted forward. Holly parried and charged. The Oak King's staff glowed with powerful orange heat, while Holly's staff frosted over with silvery blue magic. The kings battled, and their energy grew, but before either could claim victory, the ground began to rumble. Both brothers yielded to the familiar tremor, a deep, echoing quake like the one that had borne them from the skies. "Are you okay?" Holly asked when the quake stopped. "Yes," Oak replied, "but listen." The mountain was consumed in silence and stillness. The kings hurried back down the forest path to find the great stone table cracked in half. Beneath it, a fault line zigzagged down the mountain face. "We must follow this trail," Oak said. Holly agreed, and the brothers set on their quest. The fault line led the brothers to the base of their mountain. "This is the land of humans," Holly assessed. "Our exploring must end here. We are not of this world." "That may be so," Oak replied, "but we share this Earth's plane. Something is wrong with our Earth Mother. I can feel it." "I feel it too," said Holly, "but our forms may frighten the humans, for they are mortal, and we are of the stars." He stamped his staff on the ground. Glittering smoke swirled around him, and when it cleared, he had transformed into a white stag. Oak, too, struck the ground with his staff, transforming into a robin. In these forms, the kings journeyed off their mountain. In the human world, the kings observed a land that could not alter its climate as their magical mountain could. Humans everywhere scrambled to sow and harvest crops under unpredictable weather. The Oak King Robin flew over farmlands that had flooded after too much rain. The Holly King Stag wandered in forests behind houses, listening to parents singing wishes and lullaby promises to their children. Seeing this distress, the kings returned to their mountain, resumed their natural forms, and prayed. The spirits echoed in response, "What do the humans need to thrive and to care for the earth?" Oak answered first, "They require more sunlight to dry the land and return to work." Holly disagreed. "These people are tired. They need darkness and rest to heal." Thunder boomed, and aurora colors splashed across the skies. The universe called, "Twin brothers, from your mountain overlooking the human realm, you will observe the needs of the people below and determine a new path for the sun's warmth and light." The kings argued more feverishly than ever, with empathy and compassion for their earthly siblings. They drew their staffs, ready to duel, and trust the victor to the universe. Passionate swings cut through the mountain air, each brother fighting for the path he thought was best. In the end, Holly struck the final blow, thwarting his brother so keenly that Oak was cast far into the distant stars. For one whole year, the Holly King navigated low, even paths for the sun. In the human world, days were short and cool, and nights were long and quiet. People lit candles and decorated trees with colorful seed balls to feed wintering animals. Though the weather was cold, the atmosphere was festive and warm. Holly smiled to create such peace. Beneath the decked trees, he hid small trinkets and treats for children to find and enjoy. But soon the plants withered, and people became listless with little daylight for work and play. When the Oak King returned, the earth had become weak and fragile. "Brother, it is time to end your reign," Oak demanded, drawing his staff. "The earth cannot grow in such darkness." Holly replied, "Brother, you would rather scorch its soil with sunlight." He battled to defend his rule, but he was tired from carrying the weight of the sun. Oak quickly gained favor, and with a crushing blow from his glowing staff, he cast his brother far into the stars. Another year turned, this time with the Oak King raising the sun's power high to the magical mountain's peak. Slowly the land thawed, and people emerged from their homes like flowers from their buds. They danced and sang, lighting fires to honor the returned warmth. Oak was happy, and he blessed the land with vibrant colors and lush vegetation. But after some time, the humans wilted, the ground dried, and the crops crumbled. When the Holly King returned, he looked upon the parched earth and cried, "Brother, please hear me. I love you as I love our Mother Earth, and that is why I must insist you let me lay the heavy sun to rest." Oak replied, "Brother, I cannot let you freeze the earth into another year-long sleep," and he prepared to fight. The brothers dueled through the forest. The Oak King, tired and sore, took a knee in defeat when they reached the great stone table. He observed the deep fracture splitting the stone surface. "You win today," Oak sighed, "but I will return in just a half year's time to challenge your strength and intentions." Holly helped his brother to his feet. "I will be here," he promised. From that day on, the solstices were marked deeply with battles twice per year on the magical mountain. The Holly King charts the sunlight low to cool the earth, and then his brother returns at Yule, strong and rested to lift the sun high. The kings fight honorably with full reserve each solstice, trusting the strength of their intentions to the universe and blessing the earth with a balance of light and life.
Perhaps for a moment, the typewriters will stop clicking, the wheels stop rolling, the computers desist from computing, and a hush will fall over the city. For an instant in the stillness, the chiming of the celestial spheres will be heard as Earth hangs poised in the crystalline darkness, and then gracefully tilts. Let there be a season when holiness is heard and the splendor of living is revealed. Stunned to stillness by beauty, we remember who we are and why we are here. There are inexplicable mysteries. We are not alone. In the universe, there moves a wild one whose gestures alter Earth's axis toward love. In the immense darkness, everything spins with joy. The cosmos enfolds us. We are caught in a web of stars, cradled in a swaying embrace, rocked by the holy night. Babes of the universe. Let this be the time we wake to life, like spring wakes in the moment of winter solstice.
Song, a blessed
with song cries, comfort and caress me, and then my soul may hear a voice, a still small voice of love eternal. Darkness, when my fears arise, let your peace flow through.
One of the many gifts of community that we have missed while we worship online is seeing the children on Sunday mornings. The children and youth have been having in-person outdoor classes at Chalice for quite a while now. So we have some photos to share so you can see a bit of what they've been doing recently. Sunday offering is an affirmation of the generosity that makes our congregational life possible. As Buddhist teacher Pema Chodron writes, generosity is an activity that loosens us up. By offering whatever we can, a dollar, a flower, a word of encouragement, we are training in letting go. Please text your donation to Chalice. If you haven't texted a donation before, know that once you text the amount, you'll get a reply with a link to follow to enter your credit card information. And if you've already entered this information previously when you've donated, then you don't need to enter it again. Correspondingly, if your credit card information changes, you do need to update that. So if your Sunday donation is part of your pledge payment, please be sure to indicate the word pledge after the dollar amount. And also know that you can make a text donation anytime. It doesn't need to be just during this worship hour. The phone number will be on screen in a moment, and I'll also put it in the chat box. Please give generously. Join in dedicating our offering with words of affirmation. Open hearts, open minds, open doors, nurturing spirits, seeking justice within the wider world. This is our mission. When we said goodbye to 2020, we had high hopes for 2021. And I know we're grateful, incredibly grateful, for the vaccines that have brought some protection into our lives. And this has been a very hard year, following a very hard year. And we now know and understand that there won't be a magical day when the pandemic ends definitively and we can throw off our masks and run into each other's arms. Our lives now are about choices, managing risk, deciding what outings are important enough to make and which activities need to be skipped. An outing that may feel comfortable 1 week may feel too risky the next week, just our own internal ways of feeling. We're learning a new way of living, and learning a new way of living is exhausting. Decision-making is exhausting. Having to figure things out over and over again is exhausting. Our Advent hymn this year has been "People Look East." In pagan tradition, the four directions, east, south, west, and north, have meaning and associations. East is the direction of the sunrise, and so is associated with beginnings, with newness, with hope and possibility. Living in hard times, we have choices to make every day about where we keep our focus. We can give our attention to everything that is hard and bad and going wrong, or we can give our attention to what's coming over the horizon, the possibilities, the hope of a new day. I don't mean, you know, I never mean that we should ignore our real feelings. Of course, we have times of grief and despair. But after nearly 2 years of pandemic, I can say with confidence that we cannot give in to grief and despair. There is too much good in the world, too much love between friends and family, too many people working hard together for a better future. People look east. Love, the guest, is on the way. Love, the rose, is on the way. Love, the star, is on the way.
Choice to sit it out or dance. I hope you dance.
Closing words come from James Morrison. Within each of our hearts, there is a most glorious light. Go forth and let its spark help you understand what troubles both you and others. Go forth and let its light of reason be a guide in your decisions. Go forth and bring its ray of hope to those in need of help in both body and spirit, that they may find healing. Go forth and fan the flames of passion to help heal our world. Go forth and spread the warm glow of love, pushing back the darkness of the world. Go forth and share your glorious light with the world. You are invited to close our time together by singing The Well, and then everyone is invited to coffee hour. I also hope you are aware that our Christmas Eve service will be happening in person and online. So the regular Sunday morning link works Friday evening as well. If you do want to come in person, you need to sign up in advance. You can find that information on our website in the blog section of the website, the lower right-hand corner. Go in peace, go with love.